at people of faith in the Bible. Last week, of course, we considered Noah, who was asked to step out in faith to build an ark, a mighty ship, and to take on cares of all the animals in order that creation might be restarted after the great flood. An ark of all things. Can you imagine what your neighbors would say to you if you started building an ark in your backyard? My husband retired at the end of last year, and he started a woodworking as his post-retirement or post-work hobby. And I got to thinking, well, what kind of a conversation would it be if he started building an ark in our backyard and our neighbor Brett saw him? What you building, Keith? Well, I'm building an ark. My family and I are going to get onto it with pairs of all the animals on Earth so that we'll be safe when God sends the flood across the world. Right. You don't suppose we'd be invited to any more of his backyard barbecues after that conversation. Noah could not have been very popular in his neighborhood once the purpose of his boat got out. But see, here's the thing. The call of God sometimes requires us to step out in faith, even when we don't understand the end game, even when it's difficult. And Abraham did it in our reading today, as well as Noah. Now, having made the world and seen it succumb to violence and sin in the first 11 chapters of Genesis, today, we read in chapter 12 that God suddenly zeroes in on one couple, Sarah and Abraham. Our story of the relationship of God to his people, our story of the relationship of God to us, now suddenly zeroes in a little and becomes a little more personal, more one-on-one. Now, the next 13 chapters of Genesis will go on to follow the story of how God chooses this one man and woman to birth a nation of people. One person who would impact the world. One person specifically chosen by God. So I wonder, why Abraham? He must have been a pretty special guy. A man with no doubt. A man with no flaws, a man who lived his life totally devoted to God. Because, of course, those are the only kind of people that God chooses, right? Not so much. So what do we see in Abraham that would make him worthy of God's call? But let's go back a minute to those earlier chapters of Genesis to consider what we might know about Abraham leading up to his call by God in today's. Here's what we know. He lived in Ur. Now, if you don't know where Ur is, it's a city in the region of Sumu, south of Mesopotamia. That's not a baby, right? So that kind of place is where he was. So, we know that he lived in Ur with his father's family, a family that likely worshipped the pagan gods of that region. He was married to Sarah, and he was 75 years old. That's it. That's all we know about him before he was called by God to become the father of a nation. Just a guy, raising his flock, living his life. But God, in his wisdom, called Abraham to follow him anyway. Now, after his call by God, over his lifetime, of course, we learn much more about Abraham's journey through life with God. We learn about his life of faith. Nearly a quarter of the book of Genesis is devoted to Abraham's life. There are 40 Old Testament references outside of the book of Genesis to Abraham. There are nearly 75 references to Abraham in the New Testament, and even Islam holds Abraham as second only to Muhammad in his importance. Like the stories of so many of the people that God calls, the story of Abraham is that of an ordinary man who has Now, I think that Abraham's response to God's call is pretty amazing. Here he is, 75 years old, and he is told to pull up roots, leave his home, leave his extended family behind. He's roughly middle-aged when he meets him. He lived to be 175. He's made himself a place, a home, him. He's got a career. He's made himself a life. So, he's beginning to say, plenty of middle-aged people pull up roots and move to new homes, new places, new jobs. That's not the amazing part. What is remarkable is that God didn't tell him where he was going or how to get there. He simply said, leave your native country, leave your relatives, your father's family, and go to the land that I'm going to show you. Even the people in our own nation's history who felt driven to go west, young men, at least had a rough idea of the destination and the route they were going to take. But Abraham is simply told to leave and to trust that God will guide him. And the God that he's called to trust probably isn't the God that he was worshiping his whole life either. But remarkably, he does what God asks. So, circling back to my question, why Abraham? What made him so special that God would call him? I think the answer is simply because he was willing. Simply having an openness to this God who moved in his heart, trusting the promise of God to guide him, embracing the call to a higher purpose in life, to turn his own blessings into a blessing for the world, Abraham followed. Now, we read in the scripture lesson today that God made a couple of big promises to Abraham in the choosing. One, he will be given descendants and land. And two, through those blessings and Abraham's faith, the whole world will be blessed. We read that God told Abraham, all the families on earth will be blessed through you. That's quite a promise, particularly to somebody who at this point has no children. Yet, to this one man, the whole world will be impacted and blessed. Just as an aside, later on in history, we'll see God again working through one man, Jesus, for blessing the whole world. And that one man, Jesus, will call each of the disciples one at a time, and each of us to share the news one person at a time. So in our gospel lesson today that was from Matthew, Jesus said to his disciples, go and make disciples of all the nations. Bless the whole world. Baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach the new disciples to obey the commands that I, Jesus, have given. Know that I will be with you even to the end of the age. Now, I'm not entirely sure that Jesus envisioned us running around with a watering can, sprinkling people willy-nilly with a little water of baptism. Maybe he did? I don't know. But I think more likely we can read this as telling us that we're to step out in faith to spread the word, to show the world what it means to be reborn into a life with Christ. Not to be shy in the telling, and to draw others into your life as Jesus follows. And the way we do this, one person at a time, till all the nations of the world hear and know. Noah, Abraham, Jesus, the disciples, you, I. It appears that working through one person for the good of the whole earth is just the way God does things. Like Abraham, we are called, and in Christ we are blessed, so that we might share that blessing with others. We're commanded by Jesus to share our blessing. It's not something that we're to keep to ourselves. The church is not just about perpetuating itself, maintaining its own survival. It's not about Grace Lutheran becoming bigger, but it's more about the people of Grace, about you and about me being a blessing to the world. We're blessed to be a blessing. Just like we ask the question, why Abraham? You might be tempted to think about now, okay, I understand about Abraham, but why me? You might be thinking, I'm not worthy of God's call. I'm not up to the task. I don't have enough faith. I am somehow less than what God really needs. We spend so much of our lives trying to be worthy of attention, worthy of love, our pressure to look good, to drive the right car, to live in the right neighborhood, belong to the right club, have the right friends, all are driven by a need to be accepted and to feel worthy. certainly not by human standards. Consider some of the actions in his years after his call by God, stories that we learn about in those later chapters of Genesis. True, he did show faithfulness to follow God in the end. And he showed faithfulness in that story we're familiar with, where he sacrificed Isaac, his son, to God when commanded. But at least went through steps. But he also gave his wife away out of fear twice. And he condemned his son Ishmael and Hagar, his concubine, Ishmael's mom, to a near certain death until God intervened. Like so many of the deeply flawed people that God seems to choose to do his work, it's Abraham's faith, not his deeds, that matter. Blessing didn't come from what Abraham did. He became a blessing to others because he was open to the ongoing relationship that God offered him. In accepting that blessing, he could become a blessing to others. Abraham wasn't worthy, but he was willing. The Israelites weren't worthy of God's call to be his people, but they were willing. God doesn't measure us by our own views of worthiness. We are already worthy in his eyes, as long as we are willing to be his children, to be loved by him, to let him be our God and we be his people. He doesn't measure us by our success, but by our existence. He doesn't measure us by our imagined worth or lack of it, but by our openness to him. He doesn't measure us by our accomplishments, but by our openness and willingness. When God chose you to be his person, he did it because he loves you. All you have to do is accept it. We are every bit as worthy of God's call as Abraham was, precisely because we are flawed, weak at times, shaky in our faith. It is God's steadfastness that's the key, as long as we are open to his work in our lives. See, we're all prepared to answer God's call, each and every one of us. Everything in your past, in your work, in your skills, in your life and experiences, in your joys and in your sorrows, everything that you have lived and experienced up until now has formed you into who you are and has led you to this very moment in time. Your life has prepared you for this right now. It's prepared you to meet the person you're about to meet, to be that the blessing that that particular person needs at this very moment in time. You, and only you, have your unique combination of experiences and gifts that is most needed right now. This is your time to pass the blessing along. You are blessed by God to be a blessing to this world, one person. Immortal words of Mr. Rogers, who is one of my heroes. He says, if you could only sense how important you are to the lives of those you meet, how important you can be to the people you may never even dream of, there is something of yourself that you need at every meeting with another person. Some of you know that I'm a gardener. I love planting in the spring, and I love to see the literal fruits of my work as they appear over the summer. Nearly a decade ago, I decided to plant asparagus roots in a spot in my backyard. Asparagus growing is not for people who lack instant gratification. It grows and produces very slowly. You plant the roots in the spring of year one, You count defeats and admire them in the spring of your two. You admire the defeats and count them in the spring of year three. And it isn't until the spring of year four that you can actually start harvesting. So you have to be patient. You have to be willing to wait. It was a book by Barbara Kingsolver called Animal Vegetable Miracle that finally got me to plant that asparagus garden I've been thinking about. It's a nonfiction book that she wrote about her love of gardens and eating healthy. And in her book, she talked about how no matter where she lives, whether it's rented or owned, no matter for how long she plans on living there, she plants an asparagus garden. Until she lived on her farm, she rarely was in one place long enough to see the harvest begin in year four. She rarely sees the results of her planting, but she doesn't care. She considers it a gift to the next people to live there. We all love to see the results of our efforts, but the truth is you don't always see them. You may never know the impact you would have on the people you meet in life. Abraham's life was just one small contribution to the welfare of all the nations of the world. To his descendants, Jesus was born. Abraham didn't live to see the promise of God fulfilled. He didn't see more than a generation or two of his descendants. He didn't see the promised land given to the Israelites. Yet it didn't stop him from responding to the call of God in faith. It's not likely that we will see the ripple effect of our impact on all the people and on the world at large either. We will not likely see in our lifetimes the final redemption and reconciliation of the whole world that God promised through Jesus. But that should never stop us. Isn't it awesome to know that you have been chosen to impact your small stone tossed into the lake of life ripples to shores unknown by you. Even though you may never know how your act of kindness might change someone for the better, even though you may never know how sharing your life, how sharing your faith will change a life for eternity, even though you don't have the gratification of seeing your impact, you still have been called by God for a larger purpose. Your chosenness is not for your benefit, but for the benefit of the whole world. We are called to trust in the God who calls us, like he called Abraham and generations before us. We are called to have faith in a God who calls us into the business of doing something not for our own welfare, but for the salvation of the world. You know, we read in the Bible about a lot of people either being sent or going. Have you ever noticed that? Adam and Eve were sent from the garden and they sinned. The Israelites traveled to the promised land. Noah was sent onto the high seas with plants and animals needed to reseed the earth. God sent Abraham and our scripture today. Ruth and Naomi traveled to a new land and a new life. Jesus sent the disciples. Why all this sending? Why all this going? Maybe it's because God doesn't want us sitting still, complacent, content in our own little corner of our own safe, comfortable little world. Here's what it comes down to where the rubber meets the road. If you're going to reach out to the people who need your blessing right now, who don't know the good news of Jesus Christ, to reach those people who you are uniquely gifted to bless, you are probably going to have to travel over to two. It's only traveling outside the comfort zone. Amen.
I'm going to go to the next invite you, let's take a moment and just open our hearts and our minds to consider. God, we free us in the name of Jesus to live and to love and to serve our people in your name. Give us your strength. We ask for courage. is with you. Do not be discouraged. Be grateful for the gift of the Lord. It is good and joyful always and everywhere to give you praise, our loving Lord, Creator of energy and matter, heaven and earth. Therefore, we celebrate you, joining our voices with the wind and the streams, the animals and the flowers, the living and the dead, the stars and the planets, and all the company of creation, who forever sing to complain the glory of your holy name. You remember that on that night before Jesus was killed by those who feared him, he sat at a table with his friends, women and men and children, sharing in the feast of the Passover, which is the celebration of the liberation of God's people. And remembering God's power, Jesus took bread. And after he had given thanks and blessed it, he broke it and said, "This is my work and my life for you and with you. Take it, all of you, and do this remembering me." After his dinner, Jesus took the cup. He passed it to them, and it is now being passed on to us, and he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant. It is the cup of justice and peace poured out for all people. Drink it, all of you, and do this remembering me." Each time we break bread together, we participate in the body of the risen Christ, for we are the body of the risen Christ. And each time we share this cup, we participate in the new community, for we are God's hope of the new community. But if you join me in praying the prayer on your heart, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come, let us eat, for now the feast is ready." You may be seated. We will have three stations for communion this morning, two on either side of the table. The center aisle station is a gluten-free station with a gluten-free dedicated sign. If you come forward, I invite you to receive the bread, dip it in either the wine or the grape juice. The grape juice is just more personal to each other. Eat and return to your seat by the side of the room. Please know that you aren't the only person this morning that God is tapping on your shoulder, right? God's welcome and invitation is to everyone. You are worthy of this table. Everyone is welcome here. There is a place for you. Please come. Thank you.
This morning is one of my favorite mornings of the year as we give these eager, creative, imaginative children a Bible, the Word of God. And Luella, we pray that you will open this up with your family and explore the stories and ask them lots of questions and learn that God loves you so very much. And parents, we pray that you'll open that up and just dive in with Luella and spark her curiosity. We know she's a curious one. She wants to be with the other kids. So let us pray for Luella and her family as they receive their Bible this morning. If you could extend a hand in prayer as we pray for them. Lord God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for our children, their curiosity and imagination. Lord, we pray for Luella this morning and her family as they get their Bible and take it home and open it up and learn and read and explore all about you. May they each know that you love them so very much. So, Lord, we pray for Luella and all of the other children that have received their Bibles this morning. May you be with them this day and forevermore. In your name we pray. Thank you, Luella. Can we give Luella a hand?
I know that we will continue to pray for you and with you. I have a few other announcements for us. A short note of personal hygiene. Maybe a little weird, but there are, I don't know if you know this, there are people who are allergic to cologne and perfume. We have a couple that can't come to worship because of this allergy. If we just ask that you be conscious when you're getting ready on Sunday morning of the cologne and the perfume that you're putting on, we're still strong advocates for deodorant, but just ask that you hold the tone and the person back to fit and enable others to come to be conscious of. Thank you. Other announcements on September 20th, 5 p.m. to 9, I believe it's Thursday night at Backyard Grill right up the road here. Our neighbors, we are having our backyard preschool fundraiser. It's a great night to take off cooking and cleaning and have a good meal with our neighbors up the road. After this service, we'll be going downstairs for a conversation on faith and science. We invite you to come and discover more of how science can illuminate and expand our faith. I think often in our culture, it's put as these two opposite things. You're a person of science or you're a person of faith. So we'd like to go downstairs and think about the possibility that maybe you could be both. So it'll be a really interesting conversation and a place to think and explore. We're going to have just a simple sandwich lunch downstairs as we explore this fascinating and challenging subject together. We'll meet every other Sunday in Founders Hall beginning this Sunday at 4 or maybe that would be okay. I think I made that more complicated. Anyway, we have two of our high school youth that are really into science that have agreed to help facilitate this conversation. And I'm just really thankful that they are willing to come and be a part. So this is for high schoolers, it's also for middle schoolers, it's also for whatever age schooler you are. This conversation, I think, affects all of us. So come on down and join that conversation. Next week, we'll be giving our third graders our third grade Bibles. So if you have a third grader, if you have one that would like to receive a Bible, just let us know. We would love to lot of agencies. Many of you may have heard of our Mom and Pop program. We have renamed it. It is now Break Play Group. The reason we did that is because we took all kinds of people showing up. We had grandmas, we had dads, we had nannies, and it really is for anyone. So we're calling it Break Play Group now. Our next play group is meeting on Wednesday, September 26th from 9 to 10:30. Do you know of anyone that cares for a little one during the day and would like some community or place to come? This would be a good opportunity to let them know about our play group. They are going to be exploring fall leaves with crafts, sensory activities, snacks, songs, as well as playtime. And everyone is welcome. Saturday, September 29th, we have a women's retreat called Let Us Pray. The guest speaker is the editor of a national publication called Data Magazine. It's published by the WACA, with the Women's Evangelical Church of America's Women's Group. Her name is Elizabeth Simpson. The registration fee is only $10. This is a great opportunity to come and read and learn about prayer and pray together. So if you would like to register, there's a sign-up sheet on the welcome desk. It's going to be a wonderful day. The last note that I have is about this Saturday's annual fall festival put on by Rockford Lutheran Academy. They have inflatables, knocker balls, if you can have to say that. Dunk tanks, crafts, a petting zoo, chili cook-off, all kinds of wonderful things for a family to go and do. And the wristbands, regardless of where you get them, are $20. If you get them from us, $15 goes straight back to our school. So this will be a wonderful gift if you know a family with young kids that would get really excited about the inflatables. It would be really fun to get them as soon as they for this event. I believe that's all the announcements I have. I always say that, and then right after worship, I think it's like three or four more things. We're going to be done for now. Does anybody else have any announcements for the good of the moment? Oh, crap, I almost forgot. Really? Thank you, Angie.
Good morning. I'm coming forward today to let you know we are taking crap walk signups. The crap walk is a community-led fundraiser event that helps end hunger. Last year's crap walk, all of the different coalitions raised over $25,000, with 6,200 of that came back to our local Rockford communities. So this year our goal is to raise $40,000. And the reason we walk is people walk over 6 miles a day to get fresh food and water. So we're trying to raise some of the funds and awareness for some of the people who are in need of water and food. It will impact the individuals and the families for over 35 countries. And we bring awareness to those issues and raise funds for change one step at a time. How do you get involved? You can sign up to walk with us. The walk is on October 21st at the Riverfront Museum, downtown Ruby Museum. Sign up is at 1, walk steps off at 2. It's a 3.4-mile walk, and we walk along the river edge. Beautiful walk, beautiful time of the year. And if you don't want to walk, you can collect donations online or donate to our Grace Love Park page. And if you have any questions, I will be in the back. Take care of you. Thank you.
This is one of those many ways that we can give back, right? One of the many ways God may be checking you on the service. If you can go for a walk on a beautiful day, this might be a great way to give back. So think about it. Hunger is definitely an issue that is prevalent in our world. And so we give thanks for the blessings and our shortcomings. But also work to do what we can to end hunger around the world. I invite you to stand as you are able and let us receive a word of blessing. May God His power working in us to do infinitely more than we can ask and imagine. Grant you the gift of faith and hope and love. And may Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever. Amen.
Author of all eternity, giver of every perfect thing, Jesus, glory. Maker of heaven and of earth, no one can comprehend your worth. King of all the universe, Jesus, glory. Jesus.